Well, welcome to the AFCI Lounge and Beyond Cinema magazine here at Cannes. Jonathan Olsberg, Jane Corden, Steve Clark Hall.
What I'd like to say, I mean, we're talking about the direction that incentives are going, and I think there's some quite interesting things happening now, and it taps into your looking for a co-producer. Sometimes these incentives are a little bit at odds with the local producers because it's all about foreign producers coming in and making films and service industries, and people want to build their domestic industry. And so we are seeing some places where the incentives are enhanced when it's under a formal co-production treaty and there is a local producer involved. And if we see a country that has no film industry and says, we want a film industry, and they introduce an incentive, but they've got no infrastructure, what Jonathan referred to, which is 5 years down the track, let's have a look how we need to change it. The way that makes sense to change it is to start to introduce something that the local producers can make themselves part of it. So they can be making international co-productions where before they were only making domestic productions. They've hopefully learned because they've been a co-producer in an informal, non-equity way with a foreign producer, how to work in the international marketplace. There's the skill transfer. Now go to the next stage, and if you can create enhanced incentives or enhanced financial soft money that can be used by the local producer either as an equity or as something to attract it and give themselves an equity stake in it, then I think that's a very progressive way for it to go.
And where did you see that? Like, was it with District 9?
We see it in South Africa, we see it in Australia, we see it in Canada in some instances. So it's something that we're starting to see, and I think that's a very positive direction for incentives to be heading.
Steve, has any country surprised you? Have you gone somewhere and thought, I'm not sure that they're going to be able to get it together, and once you landed there and took the tour, were convinced that, okay, you know, I've been assured enough and perhaps been surprised?
I don't think that particular experience hasn't happened to me, no. What the opposite's happened, which is that I've gone in with an assumption that something's going to work and then decided actually the surprising thing is it doesn't work, and that's usually to do either with the depth of the crew, therefore the requirement to bring in more people, so suddenly your hotel and travel and transport is much higher than you had anticipated, or to do with this certainty thing, or to do with this, you know, oh, it's not actually that easy because you don't just get the tax credit, you've got to go and, you know, I don't know, there's some sort of difficult thing you have to do. You have to go and sell it to somebody or buy it from somebody, some sort of complexity. And I think it really is important that the administrators of the schemes understand the film business and don't come at it, if you like, on a tax collector's philosophy, which is to put up as many barriers as possible to actually releasing the money. It's so important. If you get caught up in a bureaucratic tangle, it's really difficult when you're trying to hold other complicated aspects of a finance plan together to suddenly find that the 18% that you were hoping to get from blah blah for this section of the budget has got caught up in some bureaucratic tangle, you're off.
Is this a function you fulfill regardless of whether you're a co-producer, line producer, executive producer? Like, do you take ownership of this sort of process?
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah. That's what I do. I mean, that is what I do. Yeah.
I think there's an honesty factor to consider in here as well. You know, as you say, when you've gone in there and things haven't been the way they seemed, it's because the film commissioner or the co-producer or the somebody in their excitement to get something somewhere has maybe misrepresented the situation.
Yeah, or lack of experience has made them over-optimistic about things.
But yeah, but it doesn't do any favours at the end of the day, does it?
It's so difficult. But it's our job as the probably senior producer on things to make that decision before you go in there. And so I don't think there's any point in me complaining, oh, I didn't realise that you can't get a photocopier here. I should have found that out before I go there.
There's a slightly subtle and unexpected problem with a new incentive that's too successful, Because if you imagine a jurisdiction where the level of infrastructure and capacity is what it is, an incentive is introduced and all of a sudden a huge volume of additional production is coming in. Very quickly, some potential advantages such as cost are wiped away. And so, our advice is always, if a new incentive is being introduced or an existing one recalibrated, is to be careful about planning what kind of growth you're after, because there have been countries that have introduced an incentive. There's been quite a lot of activity, sucked up all capacity straight away, increased costs because you had to ship in a lot of stuff, including people, and then when the production goes, the crew are used to working at a higher level in terms of pay, and it's very hard to bring them down to where they were, which might be needed in order to get more productions or to service the domestic market.
Yeah.
Have you found that the people with whom you consult are just as concerned about the domestic production as they are about bringing in the glossy?
Yeah, I think by and large that is the case. I mean, there may be some places where there isn't much of a domestic production community and they want to build that up. But they're aware that they don't want to alienate the domestic production community by focusing too much or overly focused on the international, because the domestic producers are quite noisy people, and if there's a lot of complaints and the stakeholders get to hear about there's a problem, we introduce this incentive, we've got productions coming in, nobody told us that these domestic producers were going to complain, so that has to be managed. But it's we don't find that, and if we do spot that it might happen, we make sure we try and explain.
How or why did you make the transition from producing to consulting?
There's only so much money one can lose at any one endeavor in any period of time. No, I was a producer for about 12 years. And during the same times I was producing, I also built up this consultancy business. And the consultancy business just sort of took over. I wouldn't rule out any return to the game. It's just too much fun to be
involved. Okay, so what would it take for you to return to the game?
I was looking for a job.
I'm waiting for Steve to invite me to co-produce a picture, and then it'll happen. No, it's for me, it's about stories. It's stories that I want to see told and talent that I want to be associated with. And if those work, and that, then if I believe there's a market for the product, then that's what I look for, or would look for.
Do you ever get inspired by the place, working with film commissions and yourself as well, to try and make things happen
always,
for them?
Always. I mean, I've been lucky enough to have been in Mauritius recently, helping the government with their newly announced incentive, and got to know about the country and its cultural history and its connections with South Africa, but also with the UK and with France. And, it's inevitable that one, as we've got a bit of a producer part of the brain, thinks of, well, here's a great story that we could tell. And usually what I do is discuss that with the local producers and see what their thoughts are.
Jane, do you have a preference as to whether to work with a production company or a film commission?
Well, no, I mean, I think the thing is, I kind of sit in between the two. I understand both sides of it, and that's why, as I say, my focus is really about ensuring that the incentives stay there and they grow and they deliver to the people who are financing them, at the same time as serving the needs of the people that will keep them happening. So I'm really about keeping all parties happy, really, and keeping them happening, because they're an important part of our international filmmaking. And I, like Jonathan, I love going to, I ended up in South Africa having just visited briefly and then ended up staying there for 3 years and working very closely with the people in South Africa on both sides of the story. And that's what's sort of given me a real appreciation. And, if you can help grow an industry and help train people, particularly in a place like South Africa where there's, a lot of unemployment, a lot of poverty, and if you can give people opportunities and be part of that, as the film industry is, then it's a very satisfying thing to do.
Yeah. Steve, with Bhopal, for example, and shooting in India, was it just that story had to be told there and couldn't be told anywhere else, and so let's just make it work?
Absolutely. Yeah. I mean, and look, incentives are only part of the package, and every movie that actually gets made is a miracle. And in my experience, no two movies are put together in the same way. So there aren't really absolute rules you've got to, you can lay down. Because it's so tricky, you just have to have simplicity somewhere along the line, and that's the best way to get people to go there. But as far as Bhopal's concerned, shot in India, no incentives, absolutely straightforward movie. So you can make movies without incentives. That's the point.
Yeah.
That you've got to be driven by the creative necessities of the movie. It would have been great if there'd been an incentive. You know, it would have helped. But, you know, you've just got to go make the movie.
A lot of film commissions seem to be tied into the tourism industry for that particular place. But given the amount of time it takes to produce a production, and also the amount of time it takes for everyone involved on a daily basis, do you find that when people come to town to produce a movie that they get to take advantage or get any sort of time to take a look around as like perhaps...
You mean the film crew?
Yeah, film crew.
Oh, yeah, film crew. Producers don't, but film crews do. Yeah, they get plenty of time. Yeah, absolutely.
I mentioned some research we did about this. And when we were talking to a hotel chain in the UK, trying to persuade them that having a film crew stay in their hotel had tremendous advantages. And they were saying, well, we much prefer conventions, you know, undertakers or lawyers or whatever, who come and sort of stay in the hotel for a weekend and we've sort of got them under our control. But the thing is, what we found was that may be the case. You know, maybe it could be that the spend of the convention in the hotel was greater, but they never get to see what's around. And a film crew coming into a place usually for several weeks not only stays in the hotel, they get out into the environment, they look at locations, and they usually have a very good time, especially in a film-friendly environment, and they become ambassadors for the tourism attraction. And our work on the tourism agenda, what we say to the local screen agency and tourist agency is when a production is coming to shoot, or even beforehand, plan your sort of tourism campaign at that point. You know, the film may not be released for a year down the line, but while you've got the crew there is when you should be doing some work to prepare for the launch of the film and at the same time a marketing campaign for the tourism attractions for where it's shot. Well, not necessarily even where it's shot. I mean, we did work in Scotland in relation to Braveheart, you know, Academy Award-winning film, and there was a huge increase in tourism to Stirling and the Wallace Monument, you know, when that film was released. Of course, most of the film was shot in Ireland, so you have to be aware of you know, what's going on. But, you know, be prepared is the mantra.
Does consumer behaviour and the changes of the way people have now consume movies, does that affect all of this?
That's a completely additional, another seminar.
Who knows? Tell you in 10 years' time.
I mean, what it does is create more immediacy, doesn't it? And talking about how film and tourism talk to each other, it is something that should put even more pressure on the fact that they communicate with each other along the way. Because I don't think film commissions and tourism departments generally make best advantage of each other and work together to make it work. And the delivery, particularly with the crowdfunding thing, means that people internationally are involved with the project or can be all the way through. So I think that is possibly an impact and just means that there should be more shaking of hands.
Right. You know, you could offer a crowdfunding opportunity that had attached to it some kind of discount for a visit. You know, from hotels or attractions.
Oh, I think there's huge potential there. And we've seen tourism doing that, but we haven't seen them doing it together
with
film quite as much.